Hi there, in today's video we are going to talk about how can you handle an in-flight emergency or a non-normal situation. Let's say you are flying on a cruise or during climb, so you are in normal operations, and then suddenly you have an engine failure or you have any other things that is not normal. So without further ado, let's jump right into it.
V1, rotate.
Hi there, my name is Gabriele and I help you to become a better pilot. If you're new to the channel, welcome. If you're not new, welcome back. If you really want to improve, just please consider subscribing to the channel. And if you want to support my job, please give it a like to the video because this really helps the channel to grow. Okay, so let's talk about how can you handle an in-flight emergency or a non-normal situation. First of all, what are they? So you've got an emergency or a non-normal situation, okay? They are different, okay, because a non-normal situation can be a small situation, okay? So for example, you have a small system on the aircraft that's not working anymore but doesn't affect the operation of the aircraft. That is a normal, stays within the non-normal situation, but it is not an emergency. An emergency is something that is very serious, an engine fire, for example, okay? Someone can even say an engine failure, okay? So it really depends on the type of the failure that you've got. You might have a non-normal situation or an emergency, okay? But today's video is not about how to differentiate a normal situation with an emergency situation. It's about how can you handle it. Alright, the most important thing that you need to do when facing an emergency situation is to stay calm. You need to stay calm even though the situation is not really nice, okay? Even though the situation is ugly, you need to stay calm, okay? Because only by staying calm you can really see what is going on around you. Alright, so even if you have an engine fire, there is no reason to panic. You have a specific procedure to apply and you should apply those specific procedures, okay? Because you won't get anything by panicking, okay? And I'm not saying this because I'm perfect all the time. When I face an emergency, I'm just perfect, okay? It's something that I struggle and everybody has difficulties because it's within ourselves, is as a humans, that when we face a problem, when we face an emergency, the first thing that we tend to do, because it's our DNA, it's not me, it's not you, it's our DNA, the first thing that we want to do is to run away, okay? It's to do an immediate action, okay? And that's really the worst thing that you can do on board an aircraft. When you face an emergency, you need to stay calm. In order to stay calm, what will happen if you stay calm? First of all, one of the biggest mistakes that we do as a pilot is that when you have an emergency, you fail to identify the real problem, okay? Because you have an emergency, you start to accelerate, thus you are not able to assess the real problem. And when you don't assess the real problem, you start to do procedures for the wrong problem. And thus, these things, as you can see already, will only make the situation worse. So that's why it is very important. It's the first thing, you stay calm and you work very nicely and easy on trying to find out what is the root problem of the emergency. Okay, because once you know exactly what is the problem, okay, you can actually fight that problem in the correct way. However, if you jump to the solution, if you jump to and say, okay, that's the problem, you start to do the procedures like the checklist or whatever other procedures you must do in order to face that situation, and you are actually fighting the wrong battle, okay, you're only making the situation worse, okay? But how can you identify correctly the problem? That's the first thing we need to do, okay? Because we always talk about, yeah, do the checklist, do the procedure, do this, do that, yes. But first of all, the most important thing, understand the root cause of the problem, okay? Not just the problem, but the root cause, what actually caused that problem, okay? In order to get the best outcome on dealing with the identification of the problem, okay, with the malfunction, okay, you want to identify the real malfunction, okay? Because I give you an example in order to make sure that this is clear. If you've got an engine failure, for example, okay, the root problem is that you have got an engine failure. However, because the engine failed, you're gonna have secondary system that will fail as well because they works with that engine. Okay, so the main problem is that you need to deal with the engine failure, not with the second problems. Okay. With the secondary problems. And that's what I mean by that, okay? You need to use some judgment to identify the real problem. But how can you do that? For sure, the experience helps you a lot with that. Okay, and that's why when you start as a pilot, you do the co-pilot career, then you become captain. But once you are a captain, even though you've got lots of experience, what you need to do in order to identify the problem is to use a good airmanship and CRM and be very humble. Okay, never think that since you are the captain, you know what's going on. Okay, you need to take into consideration and ask questions to the other team members. Okay, so use a good CRM, use all the available sources that you've got on board is paramount, because a lot of times what you cannot see, the co-pilot can see it, okay, or the cabin crews as well. So that's why it is very important that when you identify the problem, you take into account and you take within the loop the other team members, okay, because when you discuss the problem with the other person, you see things from another perspective, okay? You're not alone there for a reason, okay? You're not, we operate in airliners as a multi-pilot for a reason, okay? Once you identify the real problem, okay, don't start touching any switch, unless it's a memory item, for example. Because another tendency that we've got is that as soon as we have a problem, the first thing is that we try to recycle. I'm sure you open the door of your house one day, okay, and then the lights were off, okay? How many times you try to switch on and off the lights, okay? Hoping that the lights will magically come on because you're trying to switch it on and off. And that happens as well on the planes, okay? If you have a failure, let's say you switch on a system and then that system doesn't work, the first thing that you want to do is try to go off and on until it gets better. But most of the time, that will make your situation even worse. So apply the procedures is another very important thing. Okay, if there is a system that is not working, instead of trying to reset the system manually, try to understand, is it a memory item or is it a checklist item? In that case, if it's a checklist, just take the checklist and start to read the checklist, okay? Another thing, when you are into an emergency situation or in a non-normal situation, you need to read the checklist very slowly, making sure that the other team member, the other co-pilots or the captain is really aware of what you're reading, okay? Because you might still skip some lines. Happened to me many times that the co-pilot or the captain, when I was co-pilot, actually was reading the checklist, and because we were into this emergency state, we were actually rushing the thing a little bit. The captain or the co-pilot was actually skipping the points on the checklist. And sometimes, not sometimes, it's something that you don't want to do when you're reading a QRH, okay, the checklist for an emergency or normal situations, okay? So that's why the main thing is, guys, to stay calm, okay? Use the other team members, use a good CRM and airmanships, and I made a separate video where I explained what is a CRM and what is an airmanship, okay? Then apply the procedures and make sure that you use sound judgment, okay? 99% of the time, all the failures are within the manual of the planes, okay? Because you need to think about the planes were designed well before you were flying it. Like, for example, the Boeing 737 has been flying for, I don't know when was his first flight, but let's say 50 years, okay? So if you take into account all the experience of all the problems that all the pilots around the world have faced flying the 737, what happened is that every time that somebody was facing a problem that was not inside the checklist, Boeing was creating a procedure, was implementing the checklist in order to make sure that if that situation happens to you, you're gonna have a checklist, a procedure to apply, okay? But there is that 1% you may face a situation that is not within the checklist, within the manuals, okay? Because maybe you have a multiple failures that are not inside the manual, okay? There's not a checklist for that because you have a multiple failure. In that case, you really need to use sound judgment, okay? You need to prioritize, give the priority to the most important failure first, but every time you need to make sure you stay calm, you take other people into the loop, okay? And you apply the correct procedures, okay? If there are multiple procedures, just apply the procedure that is more applicable, okay? So guys, with this video, if you only take the thing that you need to stay calm, apply the right procedure and keep in the loop the other team member, it's already a huge gain for you as a pilot in your career. So if you have any question regarding this topic, leave a comment below and I will help you out. Also go to pilotclimb.com where you can subscribe for free pilot training content. I wish you a great day and I'll see you in the next one.